Have you ever experienced someone who had just one job to do, but didn't do their job? Maybe you went to a restaurant and, you know, the waiter, their only job is to show up at your table, but they never showed up at your table. And you're like, come on, you got one job, do your job. Or maybe you got into a taxi and the taxi driver didn't know how to get where you needed to go. It's like, your only job is to know how to get where people need to go. I don't know if you realize this, but that's what started World War I. True story, Franz Ferdinand was the leader of Austria, went to visit Serbia. Serbia provided a driver for him. The driver got lost, didn't know where he was going, went down a road, realized he needed to turn around, started backing up down that road. There's a guy sitting in a cafe, says to himself, I'm paraphrasing, hey, there's Ferdinand of Australia. I think I'll shoot him. Walks out, shoots him and his wife. World War I starts. If the taxi driver guy just knew how to do his job, there's no World War I. Maybe there's no World War II. Do your one job. It's just one job. Jesus gave us just one job. I don't know if you know that, but for his followers, Jesus gave just one job. So Jesus had always existed in heaven, and then he came down to earth and lived as a man. And then he died for our sins. According to the Bible, we've all sinned, and our sin separates us from God and his love. But Jesus died for us, and if we put our faith in his death, what he did on the cross, it takes our sins away so that we can be brought back into a relationship with God. By the way, people call that the gospel, the good news. So Jesus died, and then he was buried. And then 3 days later, he rose from the dead. It's a historical fact. You can prove that happened. And then he spent 40 days training his followers to lead his movement when he left. And then he went back to heaven. But before he did, he gave his followers their instructions, their marching orders, and he gave them just one job. Just one job. For instance, in a book called Matthew in the Bible, we read it. Matthew chapter 28. We're going to put all the Bible verses on the screen for you today. We give out free Bibles if you need one on your way out today at the Velcro Bar, which is our connecting place. So here's what Jesus says before he leaves. It says, then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples, it's like followers, of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always to the very end of the age. Don't call me Shirley. So Jesus says, listen, just one thing. Just one thing. What I need you to do is help God's children, his lost children, to come back into a relationship with him. That's it. One job. He said it over and over to make sure no one could miss it. Like in Mark chapter 16, verse 15, before he leaves, he says it again. He says, go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Preach is to tell, to share. Gospel is the good news that God loves us, Jesus died for us. And so he's saying, hey, share the good news that you have discovered about this God who loves you and that he's made it possible for you to be in relationship with him and go to heaven. Share it with everyone. That is your one job. He kept saying it over and over. Why? Why was this such a big deal to him? Well, we get a good picture of it in Matthew chapter 9, verse 36. So the context is that Jesus has been traveling. He's going through the towns, and it says this. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. So it says that when Jesus saw the people, he had compassion on them. So the Bible is translated from the original languages of Hebrew and Greek. The word translated compassion is my favorite word. It's the word splagna. Splagna. Some of you have heard me talk about this before. I like the word because it sounds like you just splagnod all over. Isn't it? This is a gross sounding word. It sounds like you splagnod. And guess what? That's actually what the word means. When it says he had compassion on them, it's translated from the word splagna, and the word splagna refers to your intestines. And so what it really says is when Jesus saw the people, he had intestines on them. But the verb form used of splagna basically means like when Jesus saw the crowds, his intestines were twisted and torn out of his body for them. Splagna. And the reason is because what Jesus saw made him sick. What he saw made him sick to his stomach. What did he see? So that he saw people who were like sheep without a shepherd. The idea is that they were like children without their heavenly father. We were made to do relationship with God. He loves us. We were made for his love. And seeing people who are separated, disconnected from God and his love is the worst sight in the world. And Jesus couldn't take it. It made him sick. So what does he do? Next verse. It says, then he said to his disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Ask the Lord of the harvest, therefore, to send out workers into his harvest field. He's kind of using a metaphor, but he's basically saying, man, there are so many people who need to know God, and there are so few workers, so few people who are willing to tell them, would you please pray? Like, would you please pray that God can find some people who care enough about other people that they'll do something about the fact that people are living their lives disconnected from God? Please pray. Check this out. We get the honor of being the answer to Jesus' prayer. How cool is that? 2,000 years ago, he's like, please pray that somebody will care enough to do this, and we get the honor of being the answer to Jesus' prayer. That's our one job. And the first Christians, they knew this was our one job because God, Jesus had made it so clear to them. And so like, for instance, one of the first Christian leaders, a guy named Paul, he writes about the task, the job of the church in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 18 through 20. He says, and all of this is a gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ. And God has given us this task. Here's our job of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us this wonderful message of reconciliation. So we are Christ's ambassadors. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. And so Paul says our task, our one job is reconciling people to God, helping people be brought back into a relationship with God. That's our one job. The first Christians took this incredibly seriously. So there's a book in the Bible called Acts, A-C-T-S. The idea is it's like the Acts of the early Christians. It's the history of the first churches. And we see that the churches grew and grew and grew and grew. They grew because they were doing their one job. They were out sharing the good news. They were inviting their friends to come, and so the church grew. The first Christians took this incredibly seriously. The problem is that most Christians today don't. I don't know if you guys have seen the website, youhadonejob.org. If not, you might want to check it out. It's fun. So it's devoted to people who had one job, but they didn't do their one job, and their failure is captured in a picture. I've got some examples for you. So for instance, here's one. Get ready for winter. I'm not sure I want to wear my flip-flops in the winter. How about this one? Man, you had one job. Come on, like, get it right. Here's another. I'm pretty sure those are canned peaches in the petite diced tomatoes. Those are definitely not strawberries. You had one job. Come on, man. And really? Like that? Dude, you had one job. Get it right, right? Just one thing you have to do. And I'm pretty sure that's supposed to be at the 50-yard line, right? This guy has one job. Put it at the 50. But no, it's at the 45-yard line. You had one job. When you just have one thing to do, get it right. Right? And so Jesus gave his followers just one job, and most don't do a very good job of this. In fact, the truth is most don't do it at all. There's all kinds of research been done that show most Christians never share their faith, rarely, if ever, invite anyone to church, or are never a part of a person coming back into relationship with God. What's sad is a lot of Christians seem to think that's okay. So I can follow Jesus and be a Christian and just not do that. And what I think a lot do is it's like, well, I know I'm not doing the thing I'm supposed to do, so I'll do other things to make up for it, right? But no. See, the problem is that the people we're talking about, like your friends and your neighbors and your coworkers and your family members, they are God's children. And I know for you, it's like, this is my coworker, that's the lady who cuts my hair, whatever. But they're God's children. And right now, if they don't have a relationship with him, they're like sheep without a shepherd. And nothing else matters as much to God as that. Nothing else can make up for that. Think about it this way. What if one day you're eating your bowl of cereal in the morning and you look at the milk carton and there's a picture of a missing kid on the milk carton? Have you ever seen when they do that? And you see this missing kid picture and your eyes explode because you know that kid. That's the kid who one day mysteriously showed up at your weird neighbor's house. Like, your weird neighbor got him out of his weird long van with no windows and brought him into his house. That's the kid who seems to be like living in your neighbor's basement. You're like, that's the kid. And so you realize, I can do this. I could get that kid back to his parents. And you imagine, you know, his parents must be desperately wanting their kid home. Right? They must be dying inside every day that they're separated from their kid, not knowing what's going on with their kid. But then you think, I don't know. It's kind of awkward. I call the police. It's kind of weird. I have to get all involved in it. I don't know. I'm not going to do it. But you feel kind of bad. And so you think to yourself, you know what I will do is I'll find out who the parents are, and I'll start giving the parents 10% of my income. Because I feel bad. And what I'll do is I'll start showing up at their house. Like, every Sunday morning, I will show up at their house and I will do chores for them. Like, I'll do whatever chores they ask. I will serve them in their home. And I'll sing them a couple songs. Like, I will go to their house and I'll serve and I'll sing a couple. I'll sing love songs to them and let them know how awesome they are. Because I feel bad, because I could help their kid get home, but I don't want to. Well, you'd never do that, right? Obviously, that's stupid. But it isn't that kind of exactly what we do? Like, God gave us just one job, to help his lost children get home to him. And they're his kids more than anything else. What he wants is to be with them. He wants them home. And we know that. And we are in position to do something about it, to help his kids get home. But it's kind of awkward. And maybe I don't want to do that. And so we do other stuff for God instead. Listen, God's intention for his church, for our church, is to grow. Not so we can have bigger attendance numbers. Who cares about that? But because he wants to fill his church with his lost children who need to come home to him. God's intention is for his church to grow, and you are his strategy. You are his strategy. We grow through us loving people, living out our faith outside of this place, and then inviting people, those people we love, to come into this place where they can hear the good news and hopefully come back into a relationship with God. God wants us to grow, and there is a cost when we don't grow. So what I want to do this morning is I want us to think about, what kind of church grows? What kind of church grows? Like, what do we need to be like as a church and as individuals? The church is us, it's people. What do we need to be like as individuals for our church to grow? And so I want you to imagine today kind of three signs that kind of need to hang above our church and above each of us individually as the people who are make up the church, represent the church. And here's what I hope you'll do. I hope as you hear each of these three phrases, these signs, I hope you'll kind of ask yourself, do people see those words when they look at me? And do people see those words when they look at our church? And if not, what needs to change? Okay? You ready? So we want to be a church where everybody's welcome. That is the first sign. Everybody's welcome. Do you know that when Jesus was here, like walking the earth, living here as a man, do you know that people considered Jesus absolutely scandalous? Like, scandalous. And what was scandalous about him is that he was so promiscuous. Not sexually, not in a sexual way, but Jesus was absolutely indiscriminate in who he loved. He was willing to love everyone. Like, he welcomed and embraced anyone and everyone who was interested in being loved. People who, like no one else would love, Jesus loved. Gentiles, pagans, Samaritans, prostitutes, tax collectors, lepers, sinners, Romans, cheats, slaves, adulterers, the unclean, the unwashed, the unlovable. Jesus had a heart for everybody. Everybody. And they were all drawn to him because he loved them. And it was considered absolutely scandalous. Scandalous. Like, the religious leaders of Jesus' time were shocked and dismayed about this. In fact, what they called Jesus was a friend of sinners. And they would say about him, they would say, that man welcomes sinners and he eats with them. And they meant it as a put down, but Jesus wore it like a badge of honor. With Jesus, everybody is welcome. So then Jesus died, right? We said it, and then he rose again, and then he went to heaven, but he left his followers to start this new community called the church. And the church became the kind of place that had literally never existed before in the history of our world. Like you should study it. It became a community where everybody, regardless of their ethnic background or their religion or their moral history, everybody was welcome. It was incredible. The world had never seen anything like it. All the barriers that used to separate people and make them hate each other, they were all torn down in the church because of Jesus. Never happened before. People never had come together like that. So, for instance, Aristotle, famous Greek philosopher at that time, he once said, all those who are not Greek are born slaves by nature. And that's just the way people thought back then. If you're not us, you're them. There's us and there's them, and it's us versus them. Right? There's walls, but not in Jesus' community. Not in the church. Jesus' community was one where everybody was welcome, and so they kept growing and adding more and more people. And then, over time, something started to happen. Somehow, a lot of churches began to forget that with Jesus, everybody's welcome. For instance, there is a church in the red light district of Amsterdam called Oudkerk, which is probably not the right pronunciation, but Oudkerk. And for a very long time, Oudkerk paid guards to keep the prostitutes out. Can you imagine? So, like, one time Jesus went to a dinner, and there was a bunch of religious people there, and Jesus, and this prostitute comes bursting into the dinner, and she does so because she wants to see Jesus. She wants to be near Jesus, and all the religious people are totally offended by her presence there, but Jesus totally welcomes her. And then you fast forward, and people who claim to be Jesus' followers are offended by and trying to keep the prostitutes away from Jesus. Really? Are you serious? They didn't want to add people. They just wanted to stay the way it was. That they wanted the church to be about them. Right? They wanted me, church. In this series, we're talking about the cost of not. God wants his church to grow. And man, there is a cost. There is a danger when we don't. When a church doesn't want to keep growing, like, they forget why they exist. They lose their entire purpose. They stop doing their one job, and they start thinking that the church exists for us instead of for them. Man, really bad things happen when churches forget that. And unfortunately, that happens. The truth is, it happens all the time. People just kind of shift their focus, and they lose sight of Jesus' one job for them, that we exist to reach out to love and to serve people who are not yet a part of the church. And they start thinking, no, the church exists for us. And so what happens is you start getting church attenders who evaluate and almost become kind of like professional critics of the church services that they attend. And they start saying things like, yeah, you know, I just think we need a different kind of music. And by the way, I think the music is too loud. And well, I think the sermon should be more like, but that was a good one today. You know, I'm just not getting fed really at this church. Like, people who come here should not wear those kinds of clothes. Really? Are you serious? Like, you can read about Jesus' heart for God's children who are doing life without him. You can read about the one job that Jesus gave his church. You can read about how the early churches took that one job so seriously. They gave their lives literally for that mission. And you think this is what the church is supposed to be about today? You care about how people dress? Seriously? Because that is not what the church is about. That is not the church. And let me just say to you, listen, if you have had that experience with the church, like, or maybe with some Christian people who you knew at work or in school when you were younger or something, and that experience kept you from wanting to go to church or be a Christian, I don't blame you. I would have the exact same reaction. And all I can say is, I am sorry. And what you experience is not the church. It's not. The church, when it's working right, man, there's nothing like it in the world. Barriers get broken down. Hatred gets overwhelmed with love. People with resources are so grateful to God that they stop asking, how can I get more? And they start asking, how can I give more? The sick get cared for, and the lonely get loved, and the dying get friends. And most importantly, people get reconciled to the God who loves them. God gets his lost kids home. And there is this big sign on the church and on every person who makes up the church. And it says, everybody's welcome. And because of that, when that's true, the church grows. And I think we are known at Verve, and we will continue to be known for scandalous grace, for loving people indiscriminately. Like, we'll just love anyone who's interested in being loved. We're kind of promiscuous like that. Everybody's welcome. Now, a second sign that should mark Jesus' community and each of us says, nobody's perfect. Nobody's perfect. So God tells us in the Bible in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, it says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. We've all sinned, right? Nobody's perfect. And so in Jesus' community, there's no judging. In Jesus' community, we don't separate people into like superior and inferior, better and worse. No, we're all the same. We're sinners who desperately need grace. No one is perfect. I guess that's kind of the bad news. But the good news is that imperfect people are loved with a perfect love. Imperfect people are loved with a perfect love. Imperfect you are loved with a perfect love. And that love changes everything. And it changes how you think about yourself. It changes the impact your past has on your present. It impacts how you treat other people. It changes your desires. Like, you start realizing that you don't need all the little things you've always thought you needed, but because you don't feel empty anymore. But because of God's love, you feel full. Imperfect people are loved with a perfect love, and that love changes everything, and everyone needs to experience that love. Everyone does. Listen, I know that people don't go around admitting that they're needy, right? Like people who you know, they don't go around admitting that they're empty and I just can't figure out what's missing. And I know people like to pretend that they're smart and they've got it all figured out and don't have any questions, but everyone is wanting. Everyone is needing. And what they're wanting, what they're needing, is God's perfect love. Everyone. So, who are you going to tell? Who are you going to tell? Who are you going to invite here to Verve in hopes that they'll get to experience God's perfect love here? Listen, God is not calling you to reach everybody, but he is calling you to reach somebody. And that somebody has a life that they have to live. That somebody has a death that they have to die. That somebody has an eternity they have to move into. And they need Jesus. And you don't have to be a theologian who can, you know, answer every question. And you don't need to tell them that you're right and they're wrong. And you certainly don't have to act like you're better than. You just need to let them know that God's love is changing your life. And that God loves them with the perfect love. It really is that simple. And then you invite them to come here and experience it with you. And when they show up, they're going to quickly realize that this is a place where everybody's welcome and nobody is perfect. That in this community, we don't look down, we don't pass judgment, we don't divide up into us versus them. We love each other and we encourage each other and we hold each other accountable. And that's how the church grows. And God wants us to grow. It's our one job. This is a place where nobody's perfect. The way we say it, in fact, you'll see what we have signs that say it. We say no perfect people are allowed. And so if by chance you're perfect, this is not the place for you. You're going to have to find a different place. This isn't going to work. That's the second sign. The third sign, the last one I want to talk about is, it says anything's possible. Everybody's welcome. Nobody's perfect, and anything is possible, which is Jesus' words. He said in Mark chapter 9, verse 23, everything is possible for the one who believes. But like when God comes into the picture, it changes the picture. When we believe in him, his power comes into play in our lives in a way that makes what would have formerly been impossible suddenly possible. And we've seen this together as a church. So when my family moved here 7 years ago and talked to people in Las Vegas, pastors in Las Vegas, what we were told is that you can only grow a church in Las Vegas out in the suburbs. That if you get too close to the middle of town, if you're too close to the strip, your church will not grow. So you need to be out in the suburbs. And we said, nah. And we planned ourselves here. And in less than 7 years, we have gone from 6 people who call Verve home to, I don't know, 400 or 500 people who call Verve home. And see, what no one knew is that the secret to starting a church that grows is meeting in a location that is surrounded by mattress stores. That's what we knew. No one else could figure that out. And we were also told when we moved here that that the only way churches in Las Vegas grow is if they focus on reaching displaced church people. People who already believe in Jesus, but they don't like the church they're going to in town, and so they need to find a new one. Or people who move into town, and they already believe in Jesus, already committed to him, and now they need to find a church that you can't focus on people who don't like church in Las Vegas and don't want to go to church because those people are not going to be reached. And we said, nah. Now we're going to focus on people who are like sheep without a shepherd. That's the one job that Jesus gave us. And we know from the surveys we do that about 70% of the people who come to Verve when they first show up are unchurched, unconnected spiritually. And in 6 years, we've seen 330-something people decide to put their faith in Jesus and come into a relationship with God and get baptized. Nothing is impossible. Right? All things are possible. And that's true for you as well. That's not just a corporate truth. That's an individual truth. So God has given you this one job. Okay? It's not the church's job. It's your one job for your life. You have one job. God did not give that to you and set you up to fail. Okay? He did not say, here's your one job, and man, you can't do it, but it's going to be fun watching you blow this. Like, it's just going to be hysterical to watch how bad you are at this. God did not do that, right? God set you up to win. He gave you this one job, and he's going to help you succeed with it, right? And so, if you're thinking, there are there's no way, Vince, someone like me, if you knew me, there's no way someone like me could talk to people about Jesus or get someone interested in coming to church or... If you're thinking that, you're forgetting that all things are possible for the one who believes. You know, often when people start thinking about this idea of like trying to make their faith attractive and maybe talk to somebody about God and mention Jesus and stuff like that, have some spiritual conversations, they start making all kinds of excuses. I've heard them all. They go like this. I can't share Jesus with people because I'm just not very good at that. I can't share Jesus with people because I wouldn't know what to say. I can't share Jesus with people because I would not know how to answer the questions that they would have. I can't share Jesus with people because I'm still new to this and I'm like I don't think I'm a good enough example to people. Did you notice the one common denominator in all those excuses? I, right? It's me. But here's what we learn in the Bible, and this is like, man, this is freeing truth. You should love this. I'm not the person who leads someone to Jesus. God is. God does it. He just likes to use me in doing it. And he would love to use you. That's fun for us. So there's a verse in the Bible. It's kind of like one of my like personal mottos I have to rely on. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 21 says, God was pleased through the foolishness of what was preached to save those who believe. You get it? What that's saying is, we don't need to be good. We don't need to be good at this. We can be foolish about it, right? God loves to use our foolish words and our foolish attempts to save people. He enjoys using our foolishness, right? And the answer, the truth is, God's the one who's going to do it. So we just need to pray and do our best. That's it. A couple of weeks, I think it was maybe 3 weekends ago, we had 19 people who said yes to Jesus, gave their lives to God, and got baptized all on the same weekend. Baptism is when a person says yes, makes a commitment. It's kind of a celebration of the commitment that they're making to Jesus. And what was cool is a bunch of those 19 people first came to Verve because someone invited them. One person who got baptized that weekend was Shay. Shay works at South Point with Tony. Tony comes to Verve because a couple of years ago, someone invited Tony. Well, at work, Tony would mention to Shay his church. He would mention Verve, and he'd maybe talk to someone a little about God and what God was doing in his life, and then he would invite Shay to come and check it out, and she wouldn't. And so he talked some more about God, invited her again to church, and she wouldn't. And so he invited her again, and she wouldn't, which, by the way, is not unusual. There's all kinds of research that's been done, and what they have found is typically it takes like 5 to 7 invites before a person actually shows up. The irony is most Christians give up after they invite someone once or twice because you feel like, I asked them if they wanted to come. Obviously, they would, but they didn't show up. And so if you just invited them a couple more times, they'd come, and who knows what God could do in their life. But we quit asking before what's going to happen is going to happen. But Tony just kept inviting her again and again and again. And finally, one day, Shay showed up, and she listened. And then that first day, it just made sense to her. Like, there was a Father in heaven who loved her with a perfect love. That's what she needed. And if that God was inviting her into a relationship with him, then her answer was yes. And so the next week, she was one of the 19 people who got baptized. Why? Well, because Tony invited her. You know who else got baptized that same weekend? Tony. So Tony grew up Catholic, basically went to church on Easter and Christmas, you know, sometimes, and never really understood it, never really cared. And he came here because someone invited him a couple of years ago, and it took him a while. He sat and he listened, and it took him a couple of years. During those couple of years, he wasn't sure. He just wasn't sure yet about God and this Jesus stuff, wasn't ready to make a commitment of his life to it. But the one thing he did do during those couple of years is invite his friend Shay. And so she showed up, and on her very first Sunday here, she made the decision, yes. And on that same weekend, after a couple of years of coming, Tony made that same decision, yes. And here's my question. How good could Tony have been at talking to Shay about Jesus and inviting her to his church when he wasn't sure yet the whole time if he even believed it? I'm thinking he couldn't have been that good, right? But even still, it worked, right? His foolish attempt worked. He helped her come into a relationship with God. Anything's possible. Anything's possible. And you can do this too. Maybe you can't, but you and God together, totally. You can totally do this. And listen, just to be clear, and to maybe set your mind at ease a little bit, inviting someone to church doesn't have to be weird, okay? Like, you have a way that you are all the time. You don't have to, like, change gears and switch who you are to invite someone to church. You don't have to, like, all of a sudden get religious. You don't have to say to your friend, "Friend, I've noticed that you're a sinner." And I've been thinking that perhaps, right, it doesn't have to all of a sudden get weird, right? Just be you inviting them. So you could say something like, "Hey, maybe you've heard me mention this. I go to this cool church, and like, it's helped me a lot. You want to come check it out with me maybe this weekend?" Simple, right? No pressure. You don't have to, no religious talk. It could be, "Hey, I started going to this church. Like, I've really grown a lot, like, spiritually. I've made a lot of good friends. You want to come check it out sometime? We're starting this new series. Maybe this weekend you want to check it out? It's fun. It's church for people who don't like church." Like, I assume you don't like church. I think that you'd like it. That's it, right? And what you'll find is people are more open than you think they are. You'll be surprised. We need to do this. We need to grow as a church, and you are God's strategy for us growing. We grow through loving others, living out our faith outside this place, and then inviting those people to come to this place, probably inviting them 4, 5, or 6 times before they actually show up. And then when they show up, they can hear the good news that God loves them with a perfect love and that they're invited into a relationship with him. If we don't do that, if we just say, I know, but I'm just going to keep not doing that, then there's a cost. There's a cost for us individually. There's a cost as a church. If you don't share your faith with others, you're not going to grow spiritually like you should. I promise that. Like, you mature spiritually. Your faith grows when you share it with others. It's just the way it works. And what happens is, instead of growing by sharing your faith, I don't want to sound rude, but honestly, you live your spiritual life as a selfish consumer. And that's the exact opposite of what Jesus wants for us. And what happens for us is our church doesn't grow. Eventually, we're a bunch of old farts who are complaining that the music is too loud, right? It's like, we've seen the old fart churches where everyone's complaining that the music is too loud. Let's not be that church. And more importantly, our friends and neighbors and coworkers will continue to live their life without God. Right, every day we'll see them, and they'll be like sheep without a shepherd. And then someday they're going to end their life. They're going to die, and they're going to face an eternity without Jesus. And worst of all, God doesn't get to be with his kids. That's the most heartbreaking part. I mean, like, can you imagine if your kid was the one on the milk carton? Right? If you had a kid and your kid was the one who got abducted, who was missing, you didn't know if you'd ever see him again, like, nothing else would matter to you, right? That's the reality God has to live with every single day. And nothing else as important as getting his lost kids home. That's why he gave us just one job. Let me ask you this, and then we'll pray. Who has God put into your life? Who can you invest in a relationship with so that you can earn trust and just get them to a place where they know that you love them? And then who can you invite? Let's pray. God, I know this is hard. It's challenging for all of us. It's challenging for me too. So there's no judgment. This is not a guilt thing. It's just so important and so All of us have reasons why we think we can't do this, including me. We all have excuses why it's not easy, and I don't think this could ever be a thing I'm good at or I prioritize, but this is the one thing that we have to overcome, whatever excuses, whatever reasoning we have, because this is our one job. God, would you help us to share your love, not to become weird about it, not to become Bible beaters or whatever, but just to be people who are so grateful for the grace that they've received that they just need to share it with other people. God, would you help us to invest in the relationships you've given us? Because God, the truth is, you put us in an apartment or a house here in Las Vegas, and you have strategically put us there so that we could love and reach out to the people in that neighborhood, in that apartment complex. God, you put us in a job, and we like to think, yeah, it's my career. No, you strategically put us in that job because there are people there who are like sheep without a shepherd, and that should make our stomachs turn. And you put us there so that we could love them and invite them to this place. God, you gave us a person who cuts our hair and a person at the grocery store and a garbage man. You have put people strategically into our lives so that we could represent you, and you have given us this ministry, this message of reconciliation, that we get to help people to know you and your love. And so help us to overcome whatever excuse we have, whatever reasons, and to do what you have called us to do. I pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.